used to spend my nights out in a barroom. Liquor was the only love I'd known. But you rescued me from reaching for the bottom.
Hey, brothers, we want to give a warm welcome, man, to 408 from San Jose, checking in the respects from San Jose. Welcome, brother. And we also have Big Joe 67 from Salinas, California. Hey, we got those our northern brothers here, man. Bienvenidos. And we also have Jerónimo de los Cielos, a toda madre, from Arizona. Can you guys hear me?
Yes.
You can hear me? Bobby, you can hear me?
Gotcha.
Jerónimo de los Cielos, he's over there from your part of town, Bobby, from Arizona.
Cool.
Yes. And we also have welcome. JC. Bienvenido. Welcome, brother. We also have our brother JC, our brother in arms, all the way from Washington, D.C., the Virginia area. With that said, guys, once again, man, welcome to the show. This show is about legends. This show is about bringing back the memories, the cases that our visitors, our guests have worked. And you know, Bobby, today we have a special guest. We have Darren Land. And I don't know about you, Bobby, but when I was a cop for over 36 years, 32 and five with, five as a private investigator. I call that law enforcement also. But 36 years, you meet a lot of people in your life. But, you know, Bobby, when I first moved here to Tampa area, to Apollo Beach, there was one guy that stood out. And this guy, I'm telling you, the first word out of his mouth when I met him was, I don't cheat, I don't steal, and I don't lie. And you know what? I got to know him. Now I call him my little brother. With that said, Darren, we are honored to have you. We want to honor you today. We want you to honor us with your presence. And we're going to be talking about you, about your life. But before we do, let's talk about what we're drinking. And Bobby, we'll start off with you. What you're the one only one smoking today because it's pouring down rain. But tell us what you're smoking, brother, and what you're drinking.
I'm smoking a Don Pepin Centurion. It's I love this cigar. It's kind of a sweet, spicy, peppery smoke. Everything Don Pepin. The company, they do great smokes, and I just got this over the weekend, and I had a box in my humidor, and I went through them, so I'm just starting the next batch, and I was going to get some whiskey today, but I told you I had a mishap with my pup.
Uh-huh.
I have a pup that loves to find dead critters, and he found a dead mouse rat in the park and was rolling around in it, and he smelled like ass. Ate them really quick. And was running around. So what I'm doing is having some of the tequila I had last week, Lalo. Uh-huh. It's the grandson of Don Julio. There it is right there. Love this tequila because I didn't have time to go. I'm out of whiskey right now. And
man, Bobby, I can't believe you're out of whiskey, man.
Well, over the week, last weekend, my son-in-law was in from Germany. They came here for a funeral. He's an F-35 fighter pilot. And him and my daughter are stationed in Germany. And he introduced me to this scotch. I'll probably it's a traveler's edition. You can only get it in the duty free. He got it at Heathrow at World of Whiskies. I've been there. And it's a best bottle of scotch I've ever had. And we had some of that, but obviously I don't have it with me. But maybe when I get to Abu Dhabi, I'll get it. It's a traveler's edition. I can't even remember the name of it right now, but it was really good. So all I have right now is tequila. I had some beer, but I felt like the tequila. But Darren, welcome aboard, and we're really excited to have you on. And
thank you for having me.
And the tequila is what I'm having.
Little brother, what are you drinking?
Big brother, made me an old fashioned.
Oh, nice. Okay. Yeah.
You know I make my homemade ice, my own clear ice. Need the recipe? Call me.
But yeah.
My drink I'm drinking with that today is Angels Envy Rye.
Okay.
Big bourbon whiskey fan. It's finished in a cask from Caribbean rum barrels. Mm-hmm. So it has a real sweet flavor. And when I make my old fashions, I make them with maple syrup or a brown sugar to get the sweetener. But let me tell you guys, salute. Cheers.
Salute.
Cheers. Here.
Bobby, when you come visit me over here, we're going to go to my little brother's house. He lives down the street from me. That guy has a mansion, number one. Number two, he has an indoor pool. Number three, he has a movie theater. Literally, there's his indoor pool. His indoor pool. He has a movie theater. And when I say a movie theater, I mean, this is my man cave. If you could see it, I got my little, I don't have a projector, but I got a big screen TV. This is my man cave. And I thought this was my movie theater until I met my little brother. He literally has walls. I mean, it's a huge, it's a movie theater. It's a movie theater. And every Monday we have movie night at his house. Mm-hmm. We've watched, next week we're going to watch American Me. So yes. I'm introducing him to the gangster East LA people. You know what I mean? But yes, I mean, with him, myself, and another brother that I met, great guy, Chad, outstanding guy. And I'm telling you, we have our movie night, but like he said, when we get there, he has our drink ready. He has our popcorn ready. We go upstairs and we sit down. He has movie theater seats and we watch a movie every Monday night at my little brother's house. That's the kind of guy he is. You know what I mean? That's the kind of guy he is. I'm personally drinking one of my favorite drinks. I'm drinking scotch. Glenmorangie is my favorite. And tonight, I didn't feel like opening up my other bottles. This is my old bottle. And you know what? It doesn't get better than Glenmorangie. It's one of my favorite. With that said, guys, we got some great guests coming. But before I do, Narco Dog, welcome to the show, brother. And we also got Wayne Howdy from Vista. Bienvenido, Wayne. With that said, let me read a quick bio, and then we're going to get into the questions, little brother. We're honored to have you, and we're honored for you to be a blessing to our listeners. With that said, Darren Land, Chief Petty Officer, Navy Counselor, Aviation, Warfare Specialist, NCCAW, United States Navy, retired. Chief Land is a 20-plus year distinguished U.S. Navy veteran. Chief Land enlisted in 1993, quickly rose through the U.S. Navy ranks as a result of his natural and learned leadership skills. Aviation, Boatswain's Mate, Petty Officer, Second Class, Work Center Supervisor for Operation No-Fly Zone, Recruiter in Charge of Navy Recruiting Station, Canvasseer Recruiter, Leading Petty Officer, Chief Petty Officer. Chief Land retired from Naval Service with 24 years of loyal and dedicated service, earning an honorable discharge from the U.S. Navy. Today, Chief Land has four talented adult children and is married to his best friend, beautiful Martha Land.
Yes.
Welcome to the show, brother. Bobby, it's all yours, brother.
Blessings.
Yeah. Welcome. A little bit, first of all, we always hit with the first. A little bit, tell us a little bit about yourself. Did you play sports in school? What kind of kid were you? What is it that you wanted to do when you were growing up as a young kid?
Absolutely. I actually played all sports, football, baseball, basketball, track. And where I'm from, Beaumont, Texas, small town, population about 100,000, right outside of Houston. I even played in the band. But believe it or not, I still a little bit better in the band. I actually joined the band at Texas A&M before joining the Navy. And I had a kid. She's 31 now. She's a high school teacher out in Houston, Texas right now, working on her second master's degree, becoming principal. But she, when she was born, I had to do something different. So I joined the Navy. I actually went to New Orleans, tried out for the Navy band. Next thing I know, I was at MU. Went to boot camp in San Diego, California, but I was like, you know what? The movie Top Gun's out. I want to work on a flight deck. I want to be one of those guys with that flight deck. I changed my jobs to aviation boatswain mate, launch and recovery equipment. Those are the guys who work on the green, with the green jerseys on the flight deck.
Right.
So stationed there, I was out there in San Diego, Coronado Island. Then I went to aviation school in Millington, Tennessee. Got stationed on the USS Enterprise because the way it worked back then, the better you do in your class, you can pick your duty station. So I said, I had to be a good sailor, had to bust these books out, and I studied. And I graduated number three in my class. And I got stationed aboard the USS Enterprise. Worked on that flight deck for numerous years, went around the world, crawled in the cave, Jesus was buried, seen the pyramids. Met Pope John Paul to Benjamin Netanyahu, the Prime Minister of Israel now. He was the Prime Minister back then in 96 too. So did a lot of things, experienced a lot of people. But you know, I joined the Navy because, you know, number one, I come from a long, my dad was in the Navy. Come from a long line of service people. And even at Texas A&M, I actually was going to join the Marine Corps. But, you know, God put the Navy in my path. And 24 years later, I'm nothing but blessed. It ain't where you come from. It's where you end up in life. Because I grew up poor, and I lived next to a nice guy like David.
Yes. Hey, brother, tell us a story how you met the Prime Minister from Israel.
Mm.
What's the story behind that? That's interesting.
Yeah. Yeah. So we pulled in Israel, Haifa. We were there for a week. And when we pulled out, normally we bring dignitaries and diplomats aboard the ship. I worked in primary flight control at the time. That's up there with the air boss. That's where we got flight operations going. It's a room probably, David, probably big as that room you're in right now. Probably about 19 by 19 squares. It's in the island, the superstructure of the aircraft carrier. And as we're watching flight operations, the Prime Minister came aboard to see flight operations, how we did business on the aircraft carrier. Because if you ever been on an aircraft carrier, you got probably about 25 jet aircraft on the flight deck just moving. And that's a small, 4.4 acres of U.S. soil floating anywhere. So you got this ballet going on with colored jerseys, planes moving, and people love to see that. And we're launching 12 planes within 12 minutes and catching another 12 within the next 15 minutes. So that's how I met him. We're in the same room. He came up to watch flight operations. And again, that was 96. He was Prime Minister back then. And again, Prime Minister now.
We got Anthony Progress. Welcome to the show, brother. Working on the flight deck is dangerous. Thank you for your service.
That
US,
is.
SUS. Thank you. Go ahead, Bobby.
Yeah, you covered some of the first few years of your military career. How about the promotional process? You know, obviously, I think a lot of times in law enforcement, we see it sometimes where the promotional process becomes a popularity contest. But I know that in the military, my son-in-law just did his boards for colonel. He's a lieutenant colonel right now. And his job in overseas, he's reporting to a four-star general. So if you're working for reporting to a four-star, the XO, you're probably in line for that promotion, most likely, I would guess. But anyway, on your side, the promotional process, how competitive? I'm sure, obviously you locked down and did it right because you moved up the ladder. How would you describe it, especially to anybody out there that is looking at a possible military career?
Well, from I was enlisted guy. Mm-hmm. We got a rank structure of E1 through E9.
Mm-hmm.
And I categorize those as three kind of sections. E1 through E3s, they're workers. Those are guys who are apprenticeship. They're learning their job, and they're not supervisors. And when you go from E4 through E6, these guys are supervisors. They're in charge of people. And then when you go through E7 through E9, those are managers. The Navy is the only service that E7 and above, which called chief petty officers, wear the same uniform as officers. We train all enlisted sailors, and we also train lieutenant command, about to go Army, lieutenants and below. We call those junior sailors.
Right.
So every chief, senior chief, master chief, every commanding officer has a senior enlisted, a chief, senior chief, or master chief on his watch. That's all services, by the way. But as far as promoting on my behalf, E1 through E3, basically you're an apprentice. You're taking it. You're basically time and rate, 9 months for each promotion. They go by your evaluation, your qualifications. So if you get qualified, you got good evaluations, you will be promoted. All right. Now, when we come to the supervisor ranking, it's the same thing. You have to do qualifications, evaluations, but you have to take an exam. And the way this exam works, let's say there's 100 aviation bosun mate, and we're going to promote 50 of them. You have to score better than 50 of these people, these individuals. So when you're getting promoted for these next ranks, obviously the higher you go, the tighter it gets. But once you make the rank of chief petty officer and above, there's no more exams. There's selection boards, like the officer ranking. You get your package go to a board, and you're competing against everyone in your rank.
Outstanding.
Hey, brother, once you did become a chief petty officer, you've shared with me over drinks, over a cigar several times, some of the training, not only that you went through, but that you provided, where you took your men, your women, and you took them out to the hills. And I mean, tell our listeners about some of the outstanding training you put together and also that you went through being a chief petty officer.
Yeah, when you make chief petty officer, you got to go through induction. It's kind of gentler now. Chiefs are not, how can I say this? Because, you know, as a chief petty officer, you got to earn your as the chief, because, you know, you got to be tried. You got deck plate leadership, and we'll take you out in the woods for a week, and we're going to put you through some paces, if you will. But these paces are about leadership, situational awareness. I mean, most people probably call it hazing, but it's not. There's some leadership things that go on out there, you know, during the induction season, and it's done every season. And sometimes I still get invited out to the woods. But we're training these young men and women not to think about me, individuals, because once you become a chief, you got to take care of the Navy. All right. Every sailor that comes across you. But let me explain to you, when you're in regular uniform as a regular sailor, you normally what we call wear your rating badge. You're a Navy counselor, aviation boatswain mate, a boatswain mate, a cook, whatever it may be. But once you put on the uniform of a chief petty officer, you're a Navy chief. You don't wear that ranking no more unless you're in dress uniform. People see you as chief, and they come to you with the answers. So we gotta instill, you know, into these individuals who were individuals at first. You're a part of a team now. Your company. Your company product right now. So we go out in the woods and we train. We push them to their limits. That's the best way I can say it without saying it. Because, you know, it's a secret society, it's a fraternity, and, you know, we really don't talk about it outside the mess too much.
Oh, brother, I didn't know it was a secret, man. I apologize.
No worries.
Earlier today, my son, he was in the Marine Corps, he was a grunt in infantry. Did Iraq, Afghanistan, and every now and then he'll send me some of these videos from boot camp. And he says they're funny now, but they weren't funny at the time, obviously. And
right.
He said times have changed. I think my son-in-law told me as a pilot, he had to go to serious training. And he said you knew it was make-believe, but still it sucked. It really sucked.
And that is a good way to explain it. It's like going to SEER training when you make chief. Everyone has to go through it. And yes. If you don't go through it, you're not a chief, you're E7.
Yes. Yeah. So anyway, that's very interesting. And I think, David, we talked to Benny the other day where he talked about his academy, how the academies have really changed. When I went through, we started out, I think we had 52 to my class, graduated 32. People were dropping left and right. And you're always like looking like, holy, someone's gone. I mean, every break you come back, somebody's gone, or every day. But it's changed so much now where we're losing people once they hit the street because they can't handle the stress that they used to get in the academy, which I would prefer to lose them in the academy because they're going to hurt somebody out on the street for us in our work. But I heard what David was saying. And the next question would be your creed. I love that. I don't lie, cheat, or steal.
Yes.
Explain that. That's, I love that.
Yes. And I mean, that's taught in boot camp, but as a chief petty officer, you're responsible to the commanding officer. I don't lie, cheat, nor steal, nor tolerate those among us who do. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, it's funny, the commanding officer, he'll get some, his junior officers, he'll get an answer from them. They're scared of him. That means him or her, commanding officer.
Right.
And they'll just tell them what I call that feel good shit. Right. Mm-hmm. A chief petty officer will not tell you that feel good shit. Mm-hmm. He's going to tell the commander. Then he looks at his chief and says, is it right, chief? No, sir, it's not. No, ma'am, it's not. Because that commanding officer making decisions based off information. And if we give them bad information, it can be catastrophic. Catastrophic. And that's why, you know, they put the chief in the uniform as an officer, senior enlisted. And it takes an act of Congress to demote that chief. I mean, you really, I've seen some chiefs demoted, but you really got to screw the pooch on that one. You really got to do something pretty bad. They most likely retire you. But, you know, if you think about lying, you know, I think about my mom, you know, here's the word, the truth says shit. You. Once I learned how not to lie, because when I was a young kid, I would lie just not to get in trouble. No other reason. I would just lie not to get in trouble. But if you come and face the facts with people and they tell you, and you tell them the truth, you done took the sting out of it. They don't know what else to do no more, you know? And I've learned that with my wife, believe it or not. When I made chief, you know, I learned that core value again. And, you know, she'll come at me and say, hubby, you did this. I said, I sure did. And she don't know what else to do. And that comes the next fact. Once you take the sting out of it, it'll set you free. You feel better because you ain't got to see a lot of cover a lot. But in the Navy, you know, in corporate America, friends, trust me, I will tell you the truth. Right, wrong, or indifferent. I'd rather David, my big brother, and I call him big brother since day one, tell me, you know, hey, you stink before someone in the street does. Small example, but, you know, I believe if you live by those three core values, you ain't going to have no trouble in life.
Hey, brother, we have a question from Big Joe 67. Thank you for your years of service, Mr. Land. Much respect. Mr. Land, did you go through the crossing of the equator ritual?
Yes, I'm a shellback.
Tell us about that. I don't know what that is. And Bobby, do you know what that is, the equator ritual?
I've heard of it, but I can't. I know I've heard about it on another podcast, but I don't really remember what it is. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, I'm on a rear shellback. I crossed the equator, and you got to go see Mighty King Neptune itself.
is that like something secret? Is that secret society?
Yeah. No, it's not a secret society, but, you know, aircraft carry 5,000 men and women, you know. It's a fun event. It's arduous. You crawl through leftover food. You do a lot of fun things. Everything. Then you got to go. I remember, you know, I don't know if they do it now, like I said, it's a college in the Navy. But King Neptune was the fattest guy we had on the boat. And he put grapes in his navel, and you had to go get the grape out of his navel. And you grab him by the head. You know, it's a lot of fun. Yeah. It's a long day. But, you know, you become an honorary shellback.
Yeah. Hey, nice. Big Joe, you were probably in the Navy because you know all about it, man. Hey, with that said, hey, brother, little brother, do me a favor. Share with us a memorable moment in your military career, 24 years of service, just a moment that you could say, you know what, I will never forget this.
You know, I've been around the world. I've been in a lot of countries. I've done a lot of things. But, you know, after being retired, people, that's the most memorable moments.
Yeah.
People. No, I can go on vacation to countries. I can, you know, I can do a lot of things, but, you know, I've seen airplanes crash. I've seen people lose their lives. But people, man, you know, once you put on that khaki uniform as a chief, man, I answer that. Once you put on that khaki uniform as chief, man, you know, being able to speak for sailors who can't speak for themselves and save careers. And one come in mind, Mundez, young Mexican kid in Texas, man, you know, the hardest working sailor I've met in my life. He was a second class aviation technician. He worked for me out there in Dallas. And this young man did everything right, squared away sailor. And he was going through a divorce, you know, and I'm a mentor to him. And he went to a strip club on his birthday by himself. He did all the things right. He got a cab. He just did everything right. And then as he left the club, he was drunk. He was intoxicated. And the valet gave the keys to a car. So he got in his car, and then the valet, the guy said, that's my car. The valet pulled him out, beat the guy up, called the pot cops. He called me. He said, Chief, I screwed up. He said, you know, they gave me the keys. I wasn't in my right mind. So picked him up from jail the next day. And the commanding officer was about to kick the young man out of the Navy. So when I found out, you know, normally when sailors go to the commanding officer, they have to go to a chief's board, and the chiefs pretty much decide their fate. And the chief's board, after I told him the story about the young man and brought his evaluations, chief's men say, you know what, we're going to save this sailor. But for some reason, the commanding officer said, no, I'm not going to save this sailor. He was going to make, he's going home. So I went to captain's mess with that young man, and he was ready to kick him out. And I said, give me 5 minutes of your time, sir. Gave me, read the evaluation to the CO. And I said, look at that young man. He's 24 years old. I said, I know you got a son that age. I said, look at his history. Perfect sailor. He makes one mistake, which really wasn't him. He had a plan. And you about to kick him out the Navy. For what reason? So he said, okay, Chief, based on my conversation, you know the sailor. He can stay in the Navy, but he's got work here at the headquarters. 2 months later, I got a call from the commanding officer. He said, this is the most squared away sailor I've met in my life. He said, I wish I could promote him. He's right such on. A square. He got to know that sailor. So right, my word is people, the people I met, the people I served with. But someone had a question down there, you know, why didn't I do 30? You mind if I answer that?
Yes, of course. Yeah. And as a matter of fact, the young man that asked that is JC. Great young man. He's been watching our show from the very beginning. He says, I'm barely about to reach 24 between active duty, reserve, and National Guard. So, yes, he asked me, and he also said, much respect for 24 years of service.
Once you make the rank of chief, they don't have to let you retire, and they were not, they were stop loss with me and not let me retire. And they were going to send me to D.C., and my wife said she wasn't going with me. And I'm not a politician. I feel like politicians go to D.C. That's what I'm not. And, you know, I retired as Navy counselor, but I did work at SOCOM CENTCOM. That's MacDill Air Force Base. I went from aviation to gunner's mate, and I was jumping out of helicopters, going to places, setting up perimeters, and your body gets tired. You know, I went to Chris Kyle's funeral, Navy SEAL in Dallas. You know, and after seeing so many of my shipmates, Marine Corps, commit suicide, it was a guy in Dallas, Gunnery Sergeant Land, which I should call him my cousin. He was a white guy. The guy was the epitome of Marine Corps. I mean, you look at that guy, you said Marine Corps all day long, devil dog. And when that guy committed suicide, you know, I was like, how? So, you know, it was sometimes you got no one to get off the horse. And my body, my mind, my furniture got beat up so many times on move, it was time to get off the horse.
And you know what, Chris Kilby, another man, legend from San Diego PD. It's very true what he said. Father time is undefeated. So true. Brother, little brother, share with us the time you met Colin Powell. And I know Bobby. Bobby's a fan of Colin Powell. I mean, I think every red-blooded American is a fan of Colin Powell. Tell us about your experience with him.
I met the guy at SOCOM CENTCOM, which is here in MacDill Air Force Base. That's where the Navy, everything that happens in the Persian Gulf, decisions made. You can actually see, you know, if he don't mind me disclosing this, where you live at, David.
No, it's fine.
You can see MacDill Air Force Base from David's backyard.
And you know what? On certain nights when I'm out there listening to my oldies and I turn off the oldies, smoking my cigar, I could hear them playing. What is that? Chivalry? That song?
Taps.
I could hear them across the bay, Bobby, right across the bay from me. I got St. Petersburg, and right to the right is MacDill Air Force Base. Certain nights, I could hear them playing the trumpet, and I'll literally stand up, man. I'll just look at the heavens and thank the Lord for America. But once in a while, I could hear them out there. Beautiful.
Here in the Tampa Bay area, and that guy, he's a great leader. I used to quote him a lot to my sailors, because every morning when I was in the Navy, I would email or text my sailors leadership quotes, and his was one of the ones I used to quote a lot. But this guy, man, he's a riot. He told me, he said, Chief, you know, when I was Secretary of State, I get up, I go to the plane and say United States of America on the side of it. And he said, by the time I put my first foot on that bottom step, I can hear that right engine turning. By the time I got to the top of the stairs, the left engine started turning. And he said, by the time I got in my seat, they gave me my reports and gave me my beverage, and we were taxiing. And he says, now my black ass cannot get through TSA when I take my shoes off. That guy was the epitome of humble, and I learned that from him. Humility. And you know, he was just a great guy all the way around. You know, he went through a lot, you know, as a young Army officer, Vietnam, but he's going to tell you straight, right, wrong. He will not lie, cheat, or steal. He's one of those guys.
Yeah. Hey, brother, we have a lot of active cops, a lot of retired cops, active military. JC's active military, retired military. What advice would you give let's start off with the retired. What advice would you give them? A lot of them, like myself, suffer from PTSD. A lot of them, it's after the years of service, everything that you compartmentalize, that's when the dreams, the triggers, things, yes, these canisters start leaking. What do you tell our brothers and sisters that are retired?
Well, I do suffer from PTSD. Got 70% disabled for that. What I would definitely tell anyone, document. Because we as men, you know, our generation anyway, we were told to be strong men. Don't be soft. Don't let nothing bother you. You know, we were groomed for this, you know, meaning, you know, again, remember I told you a lot of my friends committed suicide. Suck it up, buttercup. You know, that's the culture we grew up in.
Yeah.
You know, so a lot of people, they have these things, you know. I think about Robin Williams, you know, he was a comedian. I think the guy was happy every day, but the guy committed suicide, you know. So PTSD is real, you know. I've seen a lot of service members, police officers alike, because I just spoke with my ex-father-in-law. He's the chief of police in the town in Houston today, commending him on an officer that I ran across in his district. But PTSD is real. Document, you know, if you're feeling, you know, you need to speak with someone, go to a chaplain. You don't have to be a mental health counselor. Go to a friend. I would recommend, you know, you go to a friend and tell them how you feel. Because back when I was younger, people would say, you know what? Suck it up.
Yeah.
Get tough. And we did, you know. But in the back of your mind or your feelings, you struggle. And you shouldn't struggle alone. There's hotlines. There's help. There's people you can talk to. I've had a lot of say to those young men who hit that wall and going to end their career, and I would put them in my government car, and they were scared. They were scared to go to the medical because they were scared the commanding officer would find out. It would hurt their evaluation. It would hurt their promotion. So they were scared to speak up because they were scared. They would be seen in a different light. So what I would do, I would take them to the chaplain. Chaplain is undocumented and it's private. So I learned that, you know, through my own experience, you know, those things are learned traits. Initially when I was younger, it was, I'm a dude, I'm gonna suck it up. It's gonna be all right, but I go home at night and cry, you know?
Yeah.
So document, keep your medical record, you know. If you need to go to a civilian doctor versus a military doctor, where it won't be so documented, if you feel one, because it's private, you know, what you're going through is private, but definitely talk to someone. Suicide is real.
It is. It is. Bobby, anything else regarding that subject matter?
No, it's, I think a lot of it was you were, I think I mentioned it in the prior show, was involved in a shooting in 86, and back then on the PD, you just got interviewed and you went back to service. You didn't, there was no time off the way you do today. Now you get 3 days off, you got to go talk to a doctor. Back then it's like, hey, go back to work, sissy, and shut up. And I remember going home and could not go to sleep. Later on, like one of the jobs that really hit me hard was when I worked in Haiti, 2 years, I ran an anti-kidnapping team. It was a miserable place, but I loved work. It was, I've always said, I always have a special place in my heart for the Haitian people, for those Haitian cops I worked with. But I mean, I'm telling you, there were times that I would get home and I remember asking myself, what am I doing here? I already retired and I can't even go to sleep. And it got to the point where I'd walk in the door, I had a roommate, he was a NYPD, former NYPD, and he'd have a bottle of whiskey or rum. In Haiti, it's rum. There's rum is everywhere. The Dominican Republic is right there on the same island. And I started catching myself that I was drinking to fall asleep, or I was taking sleeping pills to fall asleep. And if after a while, four sleeping pills weren't enough. Four sleeping pills would get me drowsy. And I was like, all right, four sleeping pills and a double shot of rum. And then eventually I said, I got to stop this through YouTube. This is one of the things I tell a lot of people. I have a buddy of mine that was struggling. I said, go back to your faith. YouTube, there's pastors, there's that you could listen to and go to sleep to, listen to it. Sit down, grab your Bible and reconnect. It's right there. It's all at our tips of our finger. And when I was in Haiti, there were many nights I'd get back at the end of the shift. I couldn't unwind. You know, we're thinking of a victim that's still out there that we're trying to find out where they're at on a kidnapping for a ransom case. And instead of depending on a drink and sleeping pills, go to YouTube. And I used to listen to Jack Hibbs out of Chino Valley, Calvary Church over there. Love that dude. And I would listen to him. I listened to the pastor from my church here in Phoenix. So to calm me down and bring me back down instead of always depending on a bottle or something, a drink, sleeping pills. And because it's very easy to get caught into that because you'll have to sleep because you got to work the next day. And then you start counting hours in your head. Well, I only got 4 hours and 32 minutes of sleep till I got to get up and get right back at it. So it's just so much easier at times just to take some over-the-counter sleeping pills and get myself drowsy and fall asleep. And it's a vicious cycle to get into because I experienced it.
Yeah, without a doubt. Little brother, last question of the night. What do you tell that young man, that young cop watching the show, that active, that young military, that young man that is just joined or that has 5-10 years on, or JC who has 24 years? What advice do you give them now that you've been around the block, you've seen it, you're on the outside looking in? What advice do you give JC?
Well, most people, you know, I tell young men and women this. They think the military is totally something different than what it really is. It's a job. You get up, you go to work, you go home. Do you deploy? Absolutely. You do deploy, okay? But, you know, I used to tell my sailors, just getting up, going to work on time, half your job is done. The rest of it's easy. You know, you got your marching orders. You know what you're doing for the day. And half the time, you're probably goofing off with your shipmates or your brother at arms, you know. But the Navy, you know, for me, it was easy. It was easy. Once you become part of that company culture, and you, like I said, you get up, you go to work. And, you know, after that, you go home unless you're deployed. I mean, you know, once you go up in rank, obviously you carry more weight with some of the work you take home. But, you know, I recommend anyone in my personal, because you get so much, you know, that, you know, I tell everyone I grew up poor and I didn't know I was poor. Now I live in a great neighborhood next to David the Great. You know, and some other great people in this neighborhood.
Yes.
But, you know, I never seen my life like this. And that was all provided by the Navy. It taught me how to be a great father. It taught me how to be a good person. It taught me so much more than I could have learned at home. I just got back from home last night, David, meaning Houston, Texas, last night. And I see a lot of my friends. And I tell you, when I look at them, I can get 10 of them together, probably get one set of teeth. People my age, and they tell me I'm lucky. And I look down on that because I said, you know what? It's funny. The harder I work, the luckier I got. Get up, go to work, do something. Be a productive citizen, you know? So for me, the Navy gave me everything I have. It gave me the opportunity to see the world. It gave me an education. It gave me, you know, just, again, I go back to the people. I met some great people. You know, people think, when I say big brother, David, that's my big brother, y'all. You know, me, him, another guy, you know, he's a white guy. You know,
we Chad go Kelly. Rest of, good yeah, old Chad Kelly. Big shout out.
Yeah. But he's a white guy, you know. Me, him, and the day we go eat chicken and waffles in the morning, and we walk in, and I walk up to the table. I say, "It's a Mexican guy, black guy, and white guy." Walk to, it's like the start of a joke, you know. But these are my brothers. just be positive.
Yeah, hey brother, thank you very much, man. We were honored to have you, and I know that advice is sound advice. Bobby, any last words for the chief?
First of all, thank you for your service.
Thank you for your support.
Honor for you to be here. But one of the things that what you hit, as a cop, David, you can say the same thing. Yeah. How many partners, or either actual partners you rode in the same car or people that you worked around with, come from such different backgrounds in law enforcement? Yes. I mean, I had a guy that came from Baltimore. I had a Puerto Rican from New York. I had an Indiana farm boy, a redneck from the hill, a hillbilly. And yet you're brothers, you're working together. And to this day, we're still brothers. Yet we come from such different, diverse backgrounds. Hilarious, you know, like they'll hear things that we did as kids. And I had a guy tell me, "You never been frog gigging?" Like, oh, there was something wrong with me. And I was like, "Frog what?" I have no idea what he's talking about. But yeah, I love that part. And I'm sure you get the same camaraderie in the military. But then again, thanks for your service, brother.
Thank you for your support. Thank you for your service.
Little brother, thank you very much. I'm looking forward to watching American Me with you. I'm going to have my back against the wall, and you'll know why when we watch it. Brother, we love you, man. Thank you very much, and I'll see you tomorrow. I'll give you a
Roger
call.
Roger that.
Take it easy, brother. Thank you.
Thank you.
Man, Bobby, what a blessing, huh? And that's why we have this show, because we not only have law enforcement, we've had I'm gonna read off a list of people that are coming that I'm hoping we're going to begin in the next couple of weeks. But I mean, what a blessing, you know what I mean? That we're able to hear live testimonies from leaders, from legends. It's beautiful.
Right. I love his story about, you know, the whole part about, you know, just get up, work. You know, both of us, you know, I've seen the world. He's seen the world. I've traveled all over the world many times. And it was, I had that foundation by my grandparents who raised me. Hey, go out and work, you know, earn your keep. And no, awesome guest, really enjoyed having him on. And when you watch American Me, make sure you have your back to the wall and make sure have your pico close by.
Oh, without a doubt, I have a cuenta close by. Hey, Bobby, let me read off some names that we're working on to come on the show.
Sure.
Next week, for sure, we're gonna have Danny Vasquez. Danny Vasquez is the longest tenure warden in St. Quentin, a Chicano who grew up in the San Bernardino area. He still has a tattoo of the cross. Remember the cross, the circle and the three dots? This Vato was, I believe, one of the main SSU guys when they started. He became a correctional officer, worked his way up to becoming a warden, was involved, I believe, in three or four executions. The guy's a legend. But our show is going to profile his life next week. We're having him on our show, but we're also going to talk about the movie Blood In, Blood Out, because when he was the warden at St. Quentin, he's the one that gave him permission, and he actually came out in the movie Blood In, Blood Out. So we're going to
remember him.
You remember him?
I remember him.
Yes. With the little mustache. He's 80 years old now, brother. He's going to be on our show. He's a PI still and does some work. On 4/17, in 2 weeks, we're looking at bringing Steve Duncan. And Steve Duncan, I know you know him. As a matter of fact, you have your poster right there. You mind showing it real quick, Bobby? The poster?
Steve Duncan gave me this at a California Gang Task Force meeting about the same time I met you. And I grabbed two of them. I grabbed this one, and somebody else grabbed one and left it at the office at the FBI. The other one is hanging in the office in the Serb Republic of Bosnia. Chief of narcotics, I gave it to him as a parting gift because he was a kick-ass guy, did a lot of great work with us, with the U.S. government, but he's a chief of the Serbian narcotics unit right now over in Banja Luka.
Yes. And you know what? When he's on the show, make sure you tell him that, that's for where sure. it's at. He's going to profile. I'm going to get him to profile the movie Traffic, because yes. every one of those guys that was profiled, Kiki Paez, they were his informants. So yes. that 1 week, we're going to profile Blood In, Blood Out. The next week, Traffic. And then the third week, I'm looking at having Hector Bellerez, the Last Narc, come on the show to talk about the Last Narc. That's sure. going to be very interesting. And then on 5-8, you're going to help me bring this one. This one's going to be a little hard, but I know you could do it. Bring in one of the twins that brought down Chapo Guzman.
Right.
Chapo Guzman. So you know what? The next month, and then after that, we got two of your buddies. Tell us about your two buddies that are going to be, that will be coming on after May 8th, if you don't
Johnny
mind.
Johnny Vasquez was my semi-training officer when I got to narcotics. Johnny got to narcotics probably in 84, maybe 83 in Phoenix, when the cocaine explosion was starting off, and he was the guy making a lot of the buy bust kilo buys here in Phoenix, doing a lot of work with DEA, and he was one of my mentors. And Johnny's from a barrio, just one of the oldest barrios here, just east of downtown Phoenix, over by the airport. The next guy would be Steve Arona, who is the most tenured homicide detective in the history of Phoenix PD. I think wow. he did about 25 years, 26 years as a Phoenix homicide detective. Steve's from Los Angeles originally, moved to Phoenix, grew up in the Garfield area just east of downtown Phoenix, and then went to the same high school I went to, but is 4 years older than me. Great guy. He's also a brother of Lee, smokes cigars, and he'll be another one that we'll be having on shortly thereafter.
Oh, man, Bobby, I'm excited. We got some great people coming. But with that said, brother, tomorrow night we have a special show on the Gray Line. We have Hector Bravo from the Prison Guard. He's going to be on. It's going to be a great show. I know that last night we had an outstanding show. Today we have my little brother on. Tomorrow we have Hector Bravo. With that said, Bobby, any last words for our listeners?
Nothing. Just thanks for tuning in, and we'll see you in the upcoming weeks with some great guests. I'm really excited.
And I'll tell you, Bobby, as my little brother was talking, I saw you puffing in that cigar. I'm over here salivating, thinking if I wasn't a mandilon, I would have my cigar, but it's pouring down rain outside. You know what I mean? But, hey, much respect to you. Hey, brother, have a great weekend. With that said, tomorrow night on the Gray Line, Hector Bravo. Here we go. Girl.